Thanks for showing up tonight, braving the horrific weather we have here. It's supposed to be sunny, always in California. This is, I think, where my notes said, our 40th seminar for the winter informational, whatever W's and I's you want to put together. But it's pretty good. And we keep doing it because everybody keeps showing up, and so I really appreciate everybody who comes each week throughout the winter when it's hard to get out of the house because it's dark. For those of you new to the club, I don't see any terribly new faces, but just some reminders, please silence your pocket computers so that they don't interrupt our very nice speakers and wake the baby. If you need to use the restroom, feel free to come on up and do it. You know, that's not too interrupting. But if you want to have a conversation, please step outside so we don't interrupt anybody. Besides this talk this month, we've got some other exciting talks. Next week, we have the Pat Cup Adventures, Double Handing and Olsen 30 to Hawaii by Jason Lauer. The 18th will be wine tasting, Red Zinfandel, bring a bottle, $2. Some tasting glasses and a dish to share. And then the 25th is called Bait and Switch. It's a discussion of seafood fraud in Los Angeles and Santa Cruz, presented by Haley Nutzel. And then February, March, we've got some exciting talks, Rowing the Pacific Ocean, a very exciting beer tasting by Fred Molnar. Another wine tasting, a talk on a new boat that's being designed here in Santa Cruz called the Offshore 42, and a safety at sea discussion, and then once again the rules, just to get everybody refreshed before we shove it back out for Wednesday racing. So with that, tonight, I'm really excited to have Carol and Mark here. They were very generous to volunteer, even with their new partner in crime. Carol and Mark started sailing in high school here in Santa Cruz. They were part of the juniors program. They are both on the wall back there for junior yachts, women yachts, women of the year. So they're pretty decent, I hear, and on the water activity. And then Carol went up north and started sailing for the University of Washington, while Mark went down south to nicer weather and study at UCSB. I don't know if you sailed down there as well.
Not sailing.
No sailing, only the books.
The sailing work.
And then, as we learned at the AGEM, that in the process of family planning, they decided to build a boat, and they chose the El Toro, which I'll tell you more about, using stitching glue. But the remarkable thing I didn't know until I got some feedback from them was they had no plans, so they had to fabricate their plans from the one design specs. So that's pretty impressive. So help me welcome to Carol Park.
Maybe some dating passing back and forth.
I'm available to pass baby.
Yes, we'll I'm next.
Okay, so we're Carol and Mark, and we built Mel Toro for our daughter. So we want to give a disclaimer before we start in. This is more like a documentary of our experiences as opposed to like a how-to guide if anybody's interested in building an El Toro, kind of share our mistakes and what we did right and what we've learned. So please ask us questions as we go along. We're going to go through a bunch of different sections of boat building. And if you're interested in learning about something specifically or something that sounds weird, please feel free to ask us. Has anybody here built a wooden boat before? Cool. Awesome. And then how many people here have sailed in El Toro before? So, amusingly, everybody who just raised their hand is ahead of us. We have never sailed in El Toro. So, tiny bit of background. John went into this, but we were juniors here. That was us. We also got married here a couple years ago.
So last year we were down here for one of the Wednesday night dinghy races, and we were seeing the El Toros go around, the Jesters going around, and we had a hobby cat. We were kind of like, we want something that maybe we could sail with, maybe someday, or have a few of them sail around the lake or something. Carol really liked El Toros. I really liked the Jesters. I had built an International 1 meter RC sailboat. I'm like, oh, Jester's like a bigger version of that, kind of. But I always wanted to build something that actually sail ourselves. And so Carol being interested in El Toro is like finally permission to go and do this project. So that was really exciting. So that was March, I think.
Yeah,
that was
mid-March.
Yeah, and she was due in August, and so it's like we want to get this boat done before she showed up. So that was the plan.
So our boat is called the Indefatigable because the Toro is the bull. So we want to go through and give like a quick timeline just to show you how fast this method of boat building we used, how fast you can bring a boat together, because it was really amazing. Like, I was pregnant at the time, and we still just, like, powered through. So all these things that I show, we're going to go into more about how we actually did them later, but this is just, like, a timeline. So on March 24th, right after we were at Wednesday Night Racing, we ordered the plans from the El Toro Yacht Racing Association. And then on April 4th, we had completed converting the plans to a stitching glue type plan. By April 6th, we had our panels cut out. April 9th, our panels were stitched together. On April 14th, we epoxy tabbed. April 15th, we reinforced our seams with fiberglass. May 23rd, we had the seat tanks glued in. And on June 2nd, the dagger board chunk was installed. And June 5th, the deck and mast step were installed. June 12th, we fiberglassed the outer hull. July 24th, our epoxy touch-ups were complete. Look how shiny that boat is. Then we entered the setback section on August 1st. We bought a house. All progress. On September 7th, the boat skipper was born.
Oh.
December 16th, we picked it up again. Painting was complete. I should say Mark picked it up. I had kind of checked out by this point because baby. And then January 1st, just a couple days ago, we splashed the boat in the harbor. It floats. It's awesome. So it went really fast right up until we bought the house. So we're going to talk about creating the plan.
So
I'm going to focus time.
Great. Yeah, so we ordered a set of plans from the El Toro Yacht, and basically the plans are these big sheets of paper. There's three of them taped together like that, and they have a bunch of different information on it. They have pretty much every measurement you could want on the boat, which is important if you're building the boat. And so part of it was a construction guide besides just the measurements, and the construction guide showed how to do a jig build. So basically for a jig build, you're building these stations that are cross-sections of the boat. So every 2 feet you have a station there. You put the chine locks on, and then you basically attach oversized plywood panels and trim them flush. So the key point to note here is that you don't actually know the panel shapes ahead of time. You're figuring it out for trial and error, putting on trimming it down. We didn't want to have to store a jig afterwards. And we had seen this video of this guy, Sam Devlin, who built all sorts of boats using the stitching glue method where you don't need a jig. And he did like keel boats and small boats like ours, and he had a video showing how he built a boat that's pretty similar to the El Toro, and that was sort of our construction guide we used for that. So every time we were out of step, we would just see what did Sam do and do something similar. Now the problem with that is that we have to figure out the panel shapes so we can use stitching glue. Other things the plans have the official measuring jig. Paul has a copy of those, so you can hold those up to your boat and see if it measures in. So that's important. So I found this program called FreeShip, and basically you can enter in the elevation and width and everything of the boat, and it will build a 3D model of it for you, which is great. And then it does what's called developing panels, and so it'll turn the 3D curved panel into a 2D flat shape that you can then go and cut exactly precisely out of plywood. And then when you stitch these panels together, they'll take 3D shape because you have the correct 2D shape on your flat panel. We'll talk more about that later. So the problem here was that the plans were missing a few measurements at the stern and bow, and so we had to use some very basic trig to figure out those measurements and plug those in the program, and we were all set to go. Another gotcha here is that the plans have a lot of redundant information in them, and so for example, this is the bow jig and a diagram for the bow transom, and they're about a quarter of an inch off for the same measurement. We used the wrong one. We weren't using the one that the measuring jig was spec'd for. We were using the construction guides. So So our bows are slightly off.
Oh, no.
But we can fix that for next, but... So this program pre-ship gave us basically these panel shapes, and I wrote little scripts that sorted them so you could measure in from each side of the plywood. And so we just sat down at the table and copied these shapes off on plywood and cut them out. We'll go into more of that later. And we built kind of proof of concept, a paper boat. So we printed out the shapes, cut them out, and then taped them together, and it looks like a Toro. It's the right shape. So it's good enough to go ahead and cut some plywood up. It'll probably be close enough. Turned out to be pretty precise, actually.
So what kind of wood did you use?
We're going to go into that.
That is in this section. Excellent.
All right.
So once we knew it would make a paper boat, we decided we could cut out some panels. We were so excited to start building that while Mark was at work, I drove up to McBeath in Berkeley and got a bunch of marine plywood and did this really epic tie-down job in the back of his dad's truck by myself. So the reason you have to use marine plywood and not just some random like house plywood that you get at Home Depot is you want it to be rot-resistant wood in the first place. So that's jungle wood, like okume or maranti. So ours was maranti. You want no voids in the plywood, because if there's a void in the wood where you bend it there, it could crack. And then you also want exterior-grade glue on it, obviously, so it doesn't melt in the water. And then McBeath in Berkeley was the only place that we could find that would actually sell this wood in the correct thicknesses for us. So we ended up with what we got because they had that at McBeath. And we are actually looking for, this is a shot of the seal on the wood, that we got. We're actually looking for okume wood because we've heard that it's lighter. But we went for the really strong stuff and they had it and we were happy with that because for our kids, so we want it to be more like strength geared instead of racing geared. So if we want to use it to teach her to sail, we want to be able to ram it into the dock without us crying or anything. So this marine plywood comes in different thicknesses, and in that Sam Devlin video we were watching about stitching blue boat building, it was really kind of like our boat building bible. We just like referred back to it constantly. He used quarter inch marine plywood, so we bought 6mm, which is about a quarter inch. And we got 2 sheets of 6mm, 4x8 sheets, and then we also got a sheet of 4mm, thinner, and we actually ended up going back and getting another sheet of 6mm, so there's not very much 4mm on the boat. We decided it was too thin. So, here's
what,
that.
What does a sheet of that cost?
It was like $55 or something.
Yeah,
uh-huh.
$5 or $7, something like that. So yeah, it was not too bad.
Was it, you used the thinner, you didn't like the thin stuff because of ramming the docks or because you didn't think it would survive at all through the
boat
building process?
So we were planning to build the seats out of it, and we're like, this is thin enough, our foot's going to go through it.
I see.
It doesn't weigh much more to do something that's heftier.
So we just decided better safe than sorry. So the boat's pretty overweight, actually, but that's not the point. It's not the point of the boat to win a bunch of races. So here's the picture that Mark showed. It was printed out by Free Ship. So this shows the panels fit onto a 4x8 sheet of plywood. So we just clamped 2 sheets of plywood together. So we were cutting out port and starboard at the same time. And we set these out on a big table, and we got a ruler, a big yardstick, and drew a grid and measured in from the edges to get the shapes. And then we used a flexible piece of trim wood as a batten to just align them. This whole process would have been a lot easier if we'd had a T-square, so if you want to do this, invest in a T-square. The ruler method takes quite a while. So then we cut out the panels roughly using a jigsaw, and we didn't cut all the way to the lines we made because we didn't want to accidentally cut over them or make them a weird angle. And then we took a hand plane, a block plane, and we block planed them down exactly to the lines. And then we beveled the panels, so that when we opened them up, they would fit together with angles there instead of having a big gap in there because that makes it a lot stronger. And just a note, in the future, since we know this design works, we could have done these steps out of like cheap Home Depot plywood and use it as a template. So then we could lend it out to people and they could router cut around it instead of having to cut it down and block plane it. So once we had the panels cut out, we started stitching the panels together. This is the really cool part of stitching glue. So we started with the two panels at the bottom of the boat. The El Toro has like four main panels around it. It's got the two panels at the bottom and then two on the sides and then the bow and stern transoms. So we started at the bottom. We put the two panels on top of each other, and then we pre-cut these like 5-inch lengths of there was electric fence wire that Mark's dad had sitting around, and we twisted them together. We drilled holes all along the edges and twisted them together all along the bottom seam of the boat.
You can see along the edge right there.
Yeah. So then we opened it up, and it looks like the bottom of the El Toro. The curve makes it fit the shape of the boat. So then we started putting on the side panels. We drilled holes in the sides and twisted them on. But there was actually way too much tension on that. The wood is really stiff. You can see at the bow there, or yeah, that's the bow, how it's like pushing itself in. We couldn't actually get the bow transom to fit in doing that. So we had to take off all the side panels and do it again. So when we did it again, we put the bow and stern transoms on first and then fitted the side panel to it. And then we were really busy at this point. So here's a picture of how Sam Devlin did it. And one person held it and bent it so it met up with the bow and stern transoms, and then that fit a lot better. And it looks like a boat.
Was your bow and stern the same thickness?
Yeah.
So bow and stern and size?
Yeah. So it was all six. Yep. So here is a boat, but it's not stretched to the correct measurements yet. So we inserted spreaders at the gunnels. There's stations along the plans, like every 2 feet, it tells you what the measurement of the boat should be there. So we just inserted a spreader to make sure the boat was that correct measurement. And to get it into square, we check square, as you do on your boat, with a measuring tape, and then we hit things with mallets until all of the all the measurements lined up like pretty perfectly. So we just stuck in more spreaders here. So then we were ready to add some epoxy and stick it in.
So where did all this take place?
So we were building this at my parents' house. They have.
I knew it.
Yeah. So we were living in an apartment at the time, so we didn't have any place to do this. And my parents had built a new house 2 years ago and had like one room of their old house standing as a shed, but it was really just like we turned into a big workshop. It was great.
So what material did you use again for the stitching?
For the stitching, it was 16-gauge electric fence wire, but basically just really thick wire that you can twist and is strong enough not to snap. Any kind of thick wire will work. Epoxy padding. So we've got the boat in shape, and we've measured it multiple times in every dimension because this is what's going to make it hold the shape. It needs to be right before putting any epoxy on it. So we used West System 105 and Code 6. We were mostly working in the evenings after work. So the 206 is a slow hardener, so overnight turn time was completely fine for us because we weren't in a hurry anyway. If we'd been working in the morning, we could have used 205 and done multiple steps in a day, but wasn't the problem with us. And safety-wise, there's a lot of people that say they've been working with epoxy for 40 years and haven't had any allergic reactions to it, but we always wear a respirator and gloves because why not? It's the kind of thing you can develop an intolerance to. Other things about epoxy. We use a lot of thickened epoxy, so that's what the tapping is going to be on the show in a minute here. So we have this wood ply, the System 3 wood ply, which is basically just very fine sanding dust. You wouldn't want to use sanding dust, though, because it's not consistent enough. And you mix together regular epoxy in a container, and then just start adding wood flour, mixing it in until it turns into this chunky peanut butter. And you don't want it to be too thin, because then it'll start rotting places. So you prime a surface and then add the thickened epoxy onto it. We'll go with that in a bit, though. So this is what epoxy padding looks like.
Yeah.
Great. So you can see the stitches right here. And so basically what we did was we primed out with a brush with regular unthickened epoxy where we were going to put the thickened epoxy. And then with a fillet tool, we were using a rounded off stir stick. You just push the thickened, it looks like peanut butter here, into the seam. And the key note here is to not get any epoxy on the stitches because that's going to make them hard. It's going to make it very hard to take them out later. This is basically just an intermediate step. The stitches are temporary. So you put the epoxy caps in, take the stitches off, and then add more epoxy fiberglass later. It turns out using a paint stir stick round off is not the right tool for this. those tabs look really messy. This was our first time working with thickened epoxy, so we didn't know better. The lesson we learned is that any epoxy you put in the boat is pretty much permanent, or it's going to be really hard to sand off. So we should have used better tools and done a much cleaner job, making the fillets really nice before it cured. We ended up finding these paint things at Home Depot, which is very flexible plastic, and you can pretty much cut them into any shape you want. So later on in the project, we were using these as the scraper tool to apply these, the thing in epoxy that worked really well for us, and then we were done with the storage decks, so that was a bad idea. So here's the boat flipped over, and you can see all the holes where the stitches were, and we've taken the stitches out, so we just took big wire cutters, snipped it, and pulled them off. And we didn't get any epoxy in the wires, thankfully, so they all came out easily. We've read that you could use a heat gun to heat up the wire if you had to pull them out, but we didn't do that. So yeah, it's holding its shape on its own. There's no wires in it.
It was kind of nerve-wracking taking out the wires.
Right.
We were like, is it all going
to
explode?
Right. There was a lot of tension on it when we put in the stitches, and it was really hard to get the shape. So we knew that it felt like it could just pop open, but it held itself epoxy strong stuff.
So the epoxy is only on the inside?
Yeah. So at this point, it's only on the inside.
Oh, I see.
We had to flip it over to snip all of the wires and pull it out. So I talked a little bit about not doing a very clean job with the tabs, so I did a lot of sanding to smooth them out, because we were going to eventually glass over them, so you don't want them to be very bumpy, because that would make your glass tape very bumpy in the end. So lots of sanding.
About how thick is the epoxy that you got in there? Is it?
It should just be in the seam, right? So we have the panel like that inside. Is beveled, so there's a little gap right there. You just kind of want to fill the gap with it. It's just a very small little seam you're filling. But since we're using wrong tool, it ended up being much thicker than it needed to be.
Did you use any cloth or anything in those epoxy joints?
Not yet.
We're going to get to that step. So this is really just temporary, because we couldn't use fiberglass tape over it, because that would have made the stitches permanent, right?
Right.
So we needed to get the stitches out, we had to hold between the stitches. So this is just an immediate step right there.
So if you do your future job, you wouldn't see epoxy, because it'd be just the seam.
Yeah,
is that
we would have done a cleaner job of it.
I see.
But
got
you would still see it.
We would still be doing the stuff. In this step, you would still
but
see it.
Wouldn't
right?
be so
but they
long.
Wouldn't be blotchy and out from
that.
This is kind of one of the things that ends up happening late all over the place in this boat. It's just like the first time we work on epoxy, so we end up pretty common theme, put too much on in a lot of places. So Carol's going to talk about the next step, the fiberglass seam reinforcement.
Yeah. So once we had the tabs in, that wasn't really enough reinforcement to have it be permanent boat. So we had to fill in between where those stitches were before. So we did that by making some big fillets with epoxy, which is like a wider stripe of epoxy that fills over that, also thickened epoxy. And then putting that 3-inch wide fiberglass tape that you see hanging over the end of the boat there on that. So we, in the keel of the boat on that seam, we have 3 layers of fiberglass tape. We have 1 in the middle and then 1 on each side. So like at the actual keel, there's 3 layers, and then it feathers out. And then on the 2 chine seams, we had 2 layers of fiberglass tape. And then at the bow transom and stern transom, we just had 1 layer of tape. We just did 2 on the sides. Sam Devlin, our guru, did 3 on his sides, but he didn't have any flotation tanks on the sides. We figured the flotation tanks were going to add enough strength that we didn't actually need 3 on the sides also. So we're trying to save a little bit of weight there. So here's us adding the fillet. Again, we made the fillet way too big. Here I'm using like a paint scraper to put in the fillet, which is really hard, and it wasn't the right shape. So this fillet is just like way too wide. And we also primed all of the seams before we started. We thought, like, oh, this is going to go together really quick. So we just primed everything. But epoxy starts to cure. So even though we were using the slow hardener, this is also, like, I think we finished this section at, like, 11:30 at night. Things you can do before you have a baby. So we primed all the seams, and we're doing the fillets. And the ones that we hadn't done yet were already gelling. So by the time we came in to do the fillet, it wasn't sticking quite as well. It was kind of frustrating. We're also running out of brushes. We're running out of epoxy mixing cups, and we're like, can we do this? So the brush was gelling too by the end. So we're like priming things out with this hard epoxy brush. It was a little bit of a mess, but it ended up being okay. here's us at probably, you know, 11 at night. I'm looking super skeptical. Mark is putting the finishing touches on it.
Popping all the bubbles.
Yeah, trying to pop all the bubbles. But hey, it dries.
The next day.
Yeah, this is the next day after it cured. It looks, you know, semi-okay. We come in the light of day, and we're like, okay, that worked. It all stuck. But yeah, it's not not super beautiful. There were a bunch of, like, waviness and bubbles in those scenes. And again, it's just because our fillets were not very smooth and too large.
Things for next time.
So the that photo before you had... Now had some strings going across. Was that to also try and maintain shape, or is that
no? The spreading over for shape. We actually used a bunch of this pink string throughout the project when we were trying to test fit in interior features. So this picture is probably actually
finding the center line also.
Yeah. So we found the center line of the boat. And we were just constantly checking the boat for square and making sure it was the right shape. And we would use the string structurally tied across the boat to measure out from the center for like fitting the tanks and stuff.
And then the front crossbeam right there is actually the front bulkhead.
Yeah.
Of plywood closing off the bulkhead there, and so I think you're may have been using concrete.
I think the one in the middle might be station 4 with a fort.
Yeah, the middle one's probably the fort.
Yeah.
So
it's just like key stations.
What
yeah.
do you use to hold the breakers in place?
different things, actually.
Originally, this is just masking tape, which really did not work very well at all, because at this point we were filling holes in the boat, which we very quickly got over and had holes all over the place in the boat. Later on, we used finishing nails, so we would line it up and then just tap a nail in from the side, and when we needed to, like, put a panel in, we could just take the spreader out and put it back exactly where it was before. But at this stage, you have nothing like that, so masking tape.
Yeah.
That didn't work well.
Yeah, sometimes they would just kind of, like, pop themselves out, and like, whoops!
And then you have to remeasure everything, because you want to make sure it's square.
Yeah.
Because when we go and add its location, like, it sets the shape of the boat, so you want to make sure it's not warped.
So that's the next section, is adding flotation to this boat. We definitely wanted to focus on flotation since, again, we're using it for our kids. So we were looking at the El Toro website, and Paul told us to check out this article he wrote that shows all these different ways of putting flotation in your El Toro. So the one down on the bottom, the first one on the bottom, is what we saw a lot of at the Wednesday night racing. It seems like a lot of the El Toros in Santa Cruz have that. And the one on the top is what we wanted to copy. It had, like, half-length tanks. And we just thought it looked really cute, so that's why we wanted to do that. And then the one in the middle on the bottom has removable airbags, so you don't actually even have to build in any flotation if you don't want. You can just put blow-up airbags like an obby. And then the last one I just included is a fiberglass mold boat, so it's really different from ours, but it has the tanks built into the sides of the boat, so they go all the way up there. But then Paul told us about this other boat, the limb, which is also a fiberglass mold, but Paul said that the full-length seats were better than the half-length seats because they add so much stiffness to the boat. So he actually caught us just in time. We had just started putting in reinforcements to prepare for doing these half-length tanks, and then Paul told us this was better, and we looked at the boat and we're like, yeah, this seems like it's better. So we switched our design. So here we are, we have these reinforcements on the sides are for the half-length tanks, which is why they don't go all the way yet, but we fixed that. So this is strips of ash, just the long ones are strips of ash, and the wood coming down the side is just to help the clamps clamp it in place because we didn't have clamps that are that deep. You know? So then the seat tank would sit on that ash reinforcement. A note about ash. Ash is really heavy. We shouldn't have used ash. We went to McGee's and we had this textbook of wooden boat building, and we're standing there looking at all these different types of wood that we could use for our boat. We're like, we just have to pick one. So we picked ash because it was cheap and it said it was pretty rot resistant in this textbook that we lugged with us. So we got it, but yeah, it's really heavy and we could have saved a lot of weight by just doing Sitka spruce. And then we also didn't really need to have a full strip going the whole way. It could have just been little tabs, and that also would have saved some weight without compromising any strength.
Right, because the strength comes from the epoxy fillet, not from the alignment block you put under it. So, little tiny blocks.
So here we've corrected our short tanks. It now stretches all the way up to that bow bulkhead there. And then we also installed supports along the bottom. So the tank is going to come in, and the bottom will sit on that bottom support, and the top sits on that top support. And so then we installed the sides of the tanks, and we held them in place with bricks. We had a bunch of bricks sitting around, so we used them for a lot of things on this boat. They were a really good tool. So it's held in place with masking tape and bricks there against the supports that we set up. And we just stuck this in place with epoxy and held it in.
It turns out if you want to save weight on your boat, don't epoxy your bricks in.
Yeah, at this point we actually epoxied a brick into the boat by accident.
Some of those ones in the back, the epoxy had run underneath the panel. And then no, because the next day we were coming to brick.
We didn't include that picture. We did get the brick out, though. So then here we've added more reinforcement strips on top of the tanks, and these ones really do need a continuous strip all the way down because we were routing the edge, the inside edge of the tank. You don't want your knee sitting against something that's really sharp, so we wanted a round in it.
So we need someone to cut into that?
Yeah, so we routed into that support. So the next panel comes, here it is dry, and then here's the next panel tested. So that panel sits on top of those two. And we just left the edge hanging over there. So you can see it's just cut way too big. Because when we routed the edge, it just cut off the extra floor. So we did the same thing. We stuck it in place with bricks. And we used some like honey consistency epoxy. It was thickened, but not thickened quite as much on top of the supports and set it down on top of the supports and then bricked it in place. So there's a little more height to that epoxy. And then after it was dry, we did these really beautiful fillets. We finally figured out fillets. So we primed it, and then we got the peanut butter consistency, and we used that paint scraper tool and made just like a small, very smooth fillet. And this one looks really good. We're really happy with it. It's a lot smaller. And here the tank's dry. Hooray! And here the tank's dry again with a cat. And then this is the router bit we use to round over the edges. It's for like making the edges of countertops, I guess. But it did a really good job just making a smooth curve on that tank so it wouldn't be hard for ramming your knee into.
Yeah, so we got the tanks installed. So we need a mast step and a bag of work trunk, important parts of the boat. So we cut out boxes from the mast step and bag of work trunk. You can see basically we just put several coats of epoxy on the inside. And we had this 3/4 inch ash spreader, so we're going to build a box and then just stack a lid onto it. And we sealed and we put that box into the boat. And we did a very similar thing for the mast step, which is that one right there. It's cut oversized here, just a big plant that we ended up cutting the oversized bit off later. And so this is us using bricks to seal the lid on. So after we had all the insides sealed with epoxy, the final coat, we stuck it on and held it down to dry and put a little bit more on the seam. Sealed.
So this mast tube, you wouldn't normally need a tube to put your mast in for the El Toro. You just have a hole in the deck and then like a cup that receives it in the bottom. But I would, like, insisted on us having a forward flotation tank because I was pregnant at the time and I was certain that we needed somewhere to store our sandwiches when we were going sailing. So I really wanted like a float tank with a porthole to put my sandwich in, and I was not willing to compromise about it. But in retrospect, this tube is kind of dumb. It's definitely going to be susceptible to rot in the future, so.
Because it'll fill with water if we left out in the rain or something.
Yeah.
But it worked. It was a lot more work to do.
It was a lot more. It was a lot of design work.
So here's the diving board trunk. Didn't use bricks, so I just clamped it on alongside there to let it cure. And here is the diving board trunk being installed. And so you can see there's a nice, really thick epoxy fillet around there. That's the bottom of the boat. We previously cut a slot in the bottom of the boat with a circular saw when we were ready for that. So this is just sitting over that slot. There's a lot of alignment work to get this in place. The pieces of ash that are clamped right there are just temporary. So I was thinking that when we glue this in, we don't want it to be bowed like that. We want it to be straight. So there's spreaders temporarily just inside the trunk. And then this is squeezing spreaders from the outside. So when it dries in place, it'll be nice and square and unbowed at all. Because you wouldn't want to have a trunk that's too small for a dagger worth it. Would be good. So here's another picture of that being put in there. This was a really squirrely process because everything gets slippery when you prime it with epoxy. And so we're trying to like freestand place this trunk in there. And those spreaders also are just being placed in right now. Those weren't installed beforehand. So it was just this crazy alignment job to get everything in there. But it ended up working out okay. All square lined up the center line of the boat. That took a while. In the future, I think we would make the slot in the bottom of the boat way oversized, and then make the trunk extra tall so we could slip it into that slot and align it maybe with tape from the outside or something, so that it's not this slippery thing that's scooting around just trying to glue it in place. And here's the top of the fork. So the trunk's installed. It's got these ash frames going across, and we cut these plywood to sit on top of there. And more bricks. So we prime the other side of that piece of plywood, stuck it on top of our frames, and put bricks down and seal it down.
This time we got smart and put some paper towels under the bricks, so we only had to sand off paper towels and epoxy on
them. You really should have like wrapped all of these bricks in cling wrap or something, but didn't think of that this time. And here's a nice little filling of the gap between that work top and the side of the seat, because the seat is at this point rounded because we rounded it off. So we had to fill that gap right there. Looks pretty good. And here's how we sealed the bottom beforehand. We at least thought far enough ahead on this part to know that it would be hard to do a good job sealing, like looking underneath the wood. So we made sure we did the underside of that before we put it in. I almost wish we'd like painted it first too, because that was hard to paint under there. But it worked out.
Did you use any glass on that portion of the boat?
No. Pretty much the only glass on the inside is the tape on the seams here.
Everything else is just thick epoxy.
Yeah. So that was the aqua trunk. This is a much earlier photo. And you can see all of the blocks we put in for alignment. And you can see there's a bunch of details up at the bow that I was talking about here. So basically, we're going to have wood sitting on those frames. And where it goes down, there's a support frame. So we'll see that in a second. So to hold the mast up in place, basically in the bow, there's you need a T, and a T with a hole in the center. So this is us constructing the T right there. I didn't do any kind of fancy joint on it. I just butted up, and there's a piece of wood on top of it. It's epoxy down, just for the gap. So it's that.
Again, that's ash, and it's way thicker than it actually needed to be. We were just kind of following the construction guide at this point, which is from, I think, 1936 or something. We used a lot more weight here than we needed to, and it could have been lighter and still been really, really strong.
So that right there is 3 inches wide. I think the other one's 5 inches wide, which is probably several pounds more than it needs to be. That's okay. Let's move. So this is measuring where the foot of the step goes. So this is just a close-up of the bow right there. And you can see there's a little spot for the front of the T that we just showed. Hopefully someone can see up there. The construction guide said the center of the step should be 9 inches back. Truth is a little more complicated than that because really you want to get the rate right from the boat, but we didn't have a mastering thing, so we're just basically we made the box extra wide front to back, so later we can put a spacer in and it can be whatever rate we want. We want the ballpark correct, so this is measured right there. And this is the T with the mast box slid into it, so we cut a box square in the top of that T we made and then just slid the step in and put it all down with primed epoxy. Stick an epoxy on the other place. And yeah, so that's the bow. And this is putting the lid on the deck. So that key that we showed before now has a piece of plywood over it and kind of that shape right there. That's more frames bricked all down to here.
Okay, so at this point the hull is like done. That's the whole structure of the hull. So we just need to stiffen it up and finish it. So first step in that is fiberglassing and epoxy sealing. So first we sealed the inside of the boat, all the interior features. We did 2 coats of epoxy. We just did one, and then we waited for it to cure, wiped it off, sanded it, put on a second one. And then once that dried, here's the second cut. As you can see, I'm like getting pretty pregnant here, so this is the last section of the boat that I really participated in. After that, I was like, okay, peace, I'm like extremely large here. So then we flipped over the boat, and first we had to block plane off the edges of the chine and the keel, because when we fitted the plywood together, it's just sharp edges there. So we had to round it off, but not round it too much, because it's actually defined in the class rules how much that would be rounded. I think or something, so we're well within that. And then we sanded it to get it all smooth. And then there are still these stitch holes left over from when we had the wire in there. So we patched those with thickened epoxy, which is what all the brown smudges are. And so we used 6 ounce fiberglass cloth when we were doing this. Mark had worked with thinner weights of cloth before, and they sounded really hard to work with, so we decided we didn't want to attempt that. So that was the next step. We put on the fiberglass. So we were both really busy and covered in epoxy this whole process, so we don't have any pictures of us doing it. So we just included a bunch of pictures of Sam Devlin doing his, because it's exactly what we did. We followed his steps. So first you pre-cut the fiberglass cloth to the length you need. So the fiberglass cloth isn't wide enough to cover the whole entire boat, so you have to do it in two, and then you overlap them at the keel to make the keel stronger. So you just roughly pre-cut it first, and then you cut a second one that's the same piece. And then you wet out the seams with just regular non-thickened epoxy, and this gives the fiberglass cloth something to stick to, but it's not sticking to the whole boat, so you can arrange it and stretch it out. And then you put on the first side of the fiberglass cloth, and you overlap the keel, and then you just smooth it out so that it goes over the seams and lays as flat as you possibly can. And then you cut darts at the bow transom and the stern transom. And this part was actually really fun for me because I've designed clothes before, and it's really similar to how you fit clothes. So I was like, hey, I can do this. Then once it's all fit and it looks flat, then you mix up just like a ton of epoxy and start pouring it over. And this is non-thickened epoxy, it just runs. So you have just like a big amount of epoxy in your cup. And you dump it on the boat and you spread it out with a squeegee. So it really saturates all the cloth. And then once that one's done, so on this side you can see the first side's still wet, you put the second side on, and then you do the exact same thing for that. And then after this all cured, so we did all this, and it dried, and then we wiped it down, sanded it, and we put on a second coat over the top of it just to make sure all the dry spots were covered. I will take this.
Okay, so we have the outside of the hole with one fill coat of epoxy on floss, and we're going to put the keel strip and gunnels over that. So we didn't want to feel it steaming them at all, which you know maybe we should have. So we cut them into two layers. So it's like an inch or something thick. That's just way too thick of a piece of wood to bend over the curve of the boat. So when we rip them in half with the table saw, then it's nice and bendy. It just takes a lot more work to apply it. So here's the hole with the first heel strip installed. There's a slot for the diverboard trunk down there. And to get this to stay down, we can just stack bricks on it, like a picture of it, but we had this like, very delicately balanced all the way down with bricks just holding it down. And here's the second strip. So the first one's cured on there, and the second one's just ready to go. I don't have a picture of putting it on. And here's it finished, so we can see there's two strips there. Another problem with the two-layer approach is that they didn't quite meet flushly, so there was a lot of filling and sanding and thickened epoxy to make it look like it was one piece of wood. But we got it to work. Another thing we learned was we left it oversized on the bow and stern, and that was kind of a mistake because of a tripping hazard. And later on, we did this for the gunnels as well. And as I was walking around the boat after, like the next day after it all cured, it caught on my shorts, and I ended up ripping the whole thing off the side of the boat. So then we had to put it back on.
I wasn't there, so I just get this text from Mark that's like, I broke the boat, but I'm gonna fix it.
Right. So that's the nice thing about epoxy, pretty much, is you can just add more epoxy and fix mistakes like that. Then the problem is if you add too much, you can take it off, and that's hard to do. So here's the gunnels. You're probably looking at this and you're like, why is there a line tied on? What are those bricks doing up there? And so remember that we had already closed in the deck on the top of the boat, which meant that we couldn't clamp the gunnel to the side of the boat because there's nothing to clamp to on the inside. So for the 430 inches of the boat, you can see how we have all these clamps right here, and then they just off. So just tied it on really tight. And the problem with tying it on is that they want to scoop up the hole because it's sloped. So then you put bricks up there to pull it down. It was a balancing act, but once it was cured, it all worked perfectly. So here's another view of tying that on.
There's some masking tape in there too.
Some masking tape in there too, yep, to help it not scoot around. But again, once the epoxy is cured, as long as it's in the right place, it turns out great. Here's a picture of, we've got two layers on both gunnels and two layers on the keel, and I've trimmed them down. This is after I trimmed on it and ripped them off. and then here's the boat flip back over. It's looking pretty good now. We routed down, I think, a quarter inch bit, something small. The edges of the keel strip and the bevel, so they look nice and rounded, sanded and flush. And that's like looks like a boat. So next up is really finishing the painting, and this is a pretty broad step because there's lots of little tiny fix-up details we got to do at this point. So lots of fill coats on the bottom to fill in the weave of the glass, because you can still see the weave still like had one coat on it. And so we were doing something that ended up being kind of weird. Since we were usually working in the evening and like in off hours and didn't have like a whole day dedicated to this, we would do one coat of epoxy and come back the next day and sand it, because you have to sand before you put another coat on. And the problem with that is that when you're sanding, you're taking off most of what you put on the other day, so you end up having to do, you get stuck in this loop, basically, of it's not quite a good coat because I sanded off too much and you're not adding enough. There's another approach that I think next time we'll do, where if you start in the morning, you can put another coat on after it just starts to set up while it's still green, and you can just squeegee it out, and then you get a nice glossy coat in one day with no sanding, which would have saved a lot of time doing this. Another problem with sanding, you can see here is the close-up of the glass, is you get these little pinholes because you'll get some sanding dust residue in the weave, and then the next coat will not want to sit smoothly there. And so there's a lot of chasing these things down and cleaning them out and repeating until finally it looked really nice and glassy. And so that's nice and shiny after many, many coats. So eventually got there. So that the bottom is pretty much done in this picture. It's all sealed in, very nice and glossy. On the top at this point, I think we only have like two sealed coats. But there's no glass on the top, obviously, either. And also, we haven't put shear waters on yet, sort of an oversight. So I cut those out. Those are the shear waters are these things right here. I masking taped them on, and then epoxy primed, and then put a nice fillet to hold them down. And then this is them when they're all set up and done. So that was pretty good. And then this is kind of a problem because we have mixed finishing levels. We have the rest of the pole is basically sealed, right? We already have two coats. It's going to be waterproof, but suddenly we're introducing raw plywood. So days and days, more steps we had to do because we didn't think ahead in that one. Lots of sanding. epoxy sanding dust is nasty stuff, and it was getting in my eyes, so I started wearing these ski goggles and a respirator, and so that worked. So in this photo, we're going back to the very start of the boat, and we had that really bumpy seam in the middle that Philip did. I discovered this stuff called quick fair, and it's basically pre-thickened epoxy, but it has these microblooms in it, so it's easy to sand. And so all the white dots right there are filling in all of the little gaps and bumps we had in that center line filler. Yeah.
How many screws did you use?
This entire boat has two screws in it, and they were just out of convenience because we were tired of messing around with things. The two screws are, there's one coming from the outside there, right there, and one coming from the outside, the same on the other side right there, and basically just to hold that frame in to glue it. We could have taped it with masking tape like we did for everything else, but we're like, we're going to use the two brass screws.
Yeah, we bought this pack of brass screws for the boat, and then quickly realized that they weren't going to work, so.
I forget exactly what it was, but it allowed us to do two steps at once because we didn't have to tape it and wait a whole day for a cure. So, yeah, two screws. Fill little bumps with this quick fair stuff and sanded it off. It's kind of back to the note about wearing goggles and the respirator while we sand and stuff. That's the sanding dust from the epoxy. It's, like, really fine. Definitely don't want to breathe it. And your car starts to look like this. It's like, you think you brushed yourself completely off, it still gets everywhere. This is the point in the project where we bought the house. So we brought the boat to our shed, so it's no longer at my parents' house. And packed all of our stuff into the shed. So it's time to cut the inspection port holes. So there's the hole for the inspection port. Another note about cutting holes in wooden boats is you always want to make sure you seal the end grain of the wood, will look up any water that gets into it. So all of the screw holes right there, you can see they're oversized holes. And we then went in and filled it with thickened epoxy. And then once it's all cured, we'll re-drill a smaller hole and bolt that so that there's no exposed wood, any potential water source that's all sealed in. We did the same thing for some drain plugs back there. And there's not a picture of it, but we have breathe holes in all three tanks. So we figured if there's a breathe hole, we should have a plug to let it air out. Why not? Gotta talk about painting now. I was kind of doing this in off hours because Carole had Louisa, so I didn't want to like leave her for a long time with the baby. So I was like, I should really experiment with a small section of wood that's finished with the painting to get the technique down, but I didn't want to spend the time on it, so I did it on the whole boat, which was a huge mistake. So I ended up sanding off most of the first coat.
Dang.
So lots of sanding.
So that's why it's only slightly blue.
So it's only slightly blue in this. So I was trying to use this technique called roll and tip for applying glossy paint, where you use a roller to roll down your paint and it leaves roller stipple, the orange peel stipple. And you're supposed to be able to take a brush and very lightly go over it to knock down the stipple. But I'd never done this before, and I attempted it on the entire boat, which was a bad idea. So I ended up just adding brush marks all over the places. So undid that, and then did a better job with the next few coats, and ended up looking pretty good. Did a heavier roll-on, did mess around with mineral spirits, put on.
What did you use for paint?
It was Jamestown Distributors, their total boat topside paint.
Because it's a one-part?
Yeah, it's a one-part paint. Yeah, yeah. And then on the top, I had some Rust-Oleum topside paint sitting around. So I was like, okay, so the white right here in this picture is Rust-Oleum semi-gloss topside, and then the bottom is the total boat Jamestown stuff.
So for that gloss, you use the same technique. You just got better at it?
I just rolled it on. I was tired of tipping. From the semi-gloss, so I figured it didn't matter.
On the bottom?
Yeah, it looks almost flat
yeah.
in person. So
right.
We weren't as concerned with the stipple.
Yeah. And also on the inside, we didn't have glass and we didn't have as many fill coats. So there was already a little bit of just wood pattern coming through. And so we're like, I'm not going to bother trying to make a perfect finish with paint because if the underlying surface isn't already perfect, the paint's never going to look perfect. So
it looks really
good. It looks great, but the semi-gloss looks great. And I found out that putting the boat in this position, the paint inside really worked because it underside of the fort and the underside of the tower right there, and so you can kind of get up there and look at it, which is a lot easier than leaning over. And here's the inspection part attached, so I'll hold for that one there, and the drain plugs, and we are ready to splash the boat.
Babe, hand off. Okay, so here's the boat hanging out on the launch pad that you all recognize. So we don't have any blades, we don't have any spars, haven't made a sail yet, so we just have a hull, so we're just going to paddle it around by hand. There's Louisa hanging out with Mark's mom. And so when we went out, I wasn't sure how the hand paddling was going to go, so Mark has me on a leash there. So I'm like paddling around on all this tether. Here's Mark holding my tether. Then we both got in and paddled around. It was really fun. It was really stable, even without a dagger board. The boat just felt really stable. It felt really safe. It was good. We didn't put the baby in it yet, maybe later. But I think eventually we'll be able to put all three of us in it, and it'll feel safe and stable. It'll be great. Then Mark got in and paddled. Had a really good time. So it floats.
Yeah.
We're really
so happy. That's where the boat is today. That was January 1st, so it was 2 days ago.
Question.
Yeah.
Because you put bungs in the flotation tanks, is there also like a drain hole in the back?
No, there's not. No, those are really just for ventilation.
We should probably have a drain hole in the back. It would make it easier to drain
the
boat.
We found out how high the boat floated.
We made a really nice baler out of a tide container. So we at least have that. Do you want me to hit slides for you?
Yeah, sure. Okay, so future plans. We don't yet have a mast, but we do have a nice piece of Sitka spruce already cut with a sail truck rather than that we did. We just have to go and land it together, and that's the next step for that. So this is a picture, I think it's the boom here, and we built a little router jig, or like a piece of wood onto a router, that's their jig, and slid it down to cut the track right there. That's the jig we used. Just a piece of wood cut to it, and you set the depth. Yeah, so in our shed, we have half the mast sitting there, just to be finished. Similar state for the dagger board. So it's just the three pieces of marine plywood landed together. There's a 6 mil in the middle and 4 mil on each side. And it's just kind of sanded down, or it's half sanded down, we're not finished with this yet, into an airfoil shape. Interesting note about Toro is that you can't actually have an ideal airfoil shape for the dagger board or rudder because the class rules limit the thickness of the blade. So you just kind of approximate it by eye. So, other things about the next boat. We're going to open valve. So
no more sandwich compartments.
No store sandwiches, which will make finishing off the bow a lot easier. Our full-length sea tanks are going to be full-length. They won't stop at the bulkhead right there. They'll go all the way forward where ship is, which is good. And we're also going to figure out all of the panel shapes ahead of time on the computer, so we don't have to do any test fitting. We didn't have slides for it, but some of the test fit pieces didn't fit quite right. So we had to do a lot of filling to make it look like it did fit.
Yeah.
Which is one of the reasons we painted the boat and didn't just like varnish it.
So Mark has actually built a CAD program on the computer specifically for designing El Toros. It's really cool.
A bunch of junk. Wow. This is a picture of that.
So that's what the program actually generated.
Right, so I've just been messing around with
the second boat in all of our free time.
And you've modified your the daggerboard box. It looks like
it's
that bridge a little shorter.
It's a little different. I haven't finished that part yet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we made the board a little skinnier.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, and we fixed up the lines a little bit so the transoms will be the correct shape.
Yeah, we went with the measuring jig measurements.
Yeah, because the boat we actually built is right on the limit of the class rules because we used the wrong measurement from the construction guide. So this one is the correct measurement from the construction guide. So the stitching glue plans for this panel shapes.
I mean, maybe the measuring jig measurement. They just don't agree. The problem, these plans were made in 1936 and then updated in 1966 or something like that, so they really haven't been touched since then.
And also, while we're talking about the plans, the measuring jig only measures at even number stations, so there's 8 stations, they're like measured even ones, and the odd measurements are out of fare with the lines. So when you start entering this into the computer, you see the bearing curvature, the second derivative of the curve, and you see that the odd stations, it's like off. So they're off by almost just under a quarter of an inch. So for this, I threw out all the odd number measurements and only used even number measurements to get a nice fair curve. So it'll help with the next one. Other advantages of having on the computer is that you know the surface area of every single panel and the material it's made out of and the thickness. And so you can build a weight budget of what is each panel actually going to weigh. So I took a piece of our 6mm and 4mm wood and figured out what the full panel size is. And what supplies we use, how much surface area has to be glass, plus system has a formula for how much does it weigh to put a 6 ounce cloth with 3 full coats. So that boat we just showed a picture of is 70.47 pounds. Our boat is about 80 pounds, and the class minimum is 60 pounds for a boat, for Toro. So, and this is all 6mm also, so we'll be able to play around with what are we going to make 4mm to save some weight, where we do that and stuff. And this is the export of the panel, but we care about that. So. You think it's cool. So yeah, that's all the 2D panels.
It's like they're all nested on these 4x8
right.
sheets of plywood.
So for the boat we built, we basically just had these right here. But for the next one, we also have the seat tanks and not shown what we have. The V panels and everything also. So we're going to be able to cut out every single piece of wood for the boat, like a kit, basically.
Yeah.
And then just assemble the kit rather than doing this measuring testing.
Yeah, we had to do a lot of test fitting, and we're just going to totally eliminate that. So if you thought our boat went together fast, the next one's going to go together way faster.
And also there's annotations not shown here. So these sit on top of these outer panels, right? The inner panels, the alignment marks on it. And so, not in the screenshot, but it can also show where dotted along that panel those go. So when you plot it out in wood, you can then just align it. You don't have to do as much measuring and stuff. So it'll help the boat square with less measuring.
So, that's the state of our boat. Do you have any other questions?
So can you plug those plans into a routing CNC machine?
Yeah,
we could also cut them out as a template, like we said, with half-inch Home Depot plywood, and then we'd be able to lend it out to other people in the fleet if they wanted to make the same boat, since we know it's plywood.
Awesome.
Yeah, so sometime in the next year or two, we'll be building a second boat.
Can you put all your holes in that and drill those plans?
Yeah, in the templates? Yeah, so I was thinking that you have these annotation points on the inside panel, and so, if you just put the hole in the right spot on the template, then you get a pencil and whatever, and fill straight through.
Then they'll match when you put it together.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, because that was another thing that you did years ago. Yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned the name of a program. I didn't get it. That took the 2D to 3D?
Yeah, the 3D to 2D. So we used FreeShip, which is some obscure...
FreeShip?
Yeah, FreeShip is for Windows. It's a free open source program. It's written in Delft or something weird. And it's kind of an obscure program, and that's why I've been messing around with just software developer by day, so writing my own one, if I don't have to use a subscale program that can build the panels for me. Because I would not want to use that program to design the entire boat, because doing interior features with it, I tried and it didn't take much time. Probably would have been quicker than writing a program from scratch for it.
But less fun, right?
Less fun, yeah.
You said in between coats of epoxy you wiped it down.
Yeah.
What did you use to get the Emmy blush off of the
West? So I just used a damp cloth to get the blush off. We didn't really have, it's weird, so people talk about blush on the West system to blushing epoxy. It didn't cause a problem for us in the sandpaper, but maybe that's just because we wiped it. We were just following the recommended guidelines for that. So yeah, we just got a towel, dipped in some water, brushed it off, let it dry in the sun, and then sanded it.
Sometimes when we were trying to get sanding dust off of stuff, though, epoxy dust, we did use some rubbing alcohol on it.
Yeah,
but,
we got lazier with that over time than just water.
Yeah, it was mostly just water. And then as the boat got waterproof, we started actually hosing down
off
the boat,
yeah,
and wiping it off.
Yeah.
So would you still use the plywood for the bow and the stern and the foils and stuff? Or would you use, because we used mahogany and it was a lot easier, I would think.
The bow and the stern.
The
transom?
The transoms.
Mahogany, really?
Yeah.
A flat sheet of it? That's,
yeah.
Isn't that really thick and heavy? Or do you get thin mahogany?
Mm.
I don't know.
The plans actually call for a 3/4-inch thick bow transom and stern transom.
Right, out of plywood.
Yeah.
But
we thought that sounded absurdly thick, so we just did the 6mm.
Yeah. I mean, the plywood is actually pretty easy
to
work with.
Yeah.
There's just the block planing and jigsaw, which we would have had to do with a 3/4-inch thick anyway.
And I think that the full-length seat tanks really do help with stiffness.
Yeah.
Because when I built the little paper model, it's super flexible when you have just the outer panels. But as soon as you tape in these long seat tanks, your paper model is completely stiff. You can hold it. It's a piece of paper. You just hold the bow, and it's that's a stiff little piece of paper just because you added seats there. So it seems to really help with that.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Omar.
So, can you give us a list of tools you use? I've heard block planer and
so we were talking about making
a
slide, and we're like, nobody cares. So not that many tools really. So jigsaw is a big one. Block plane.
Also a big one. We also used a router quite a few times,
router
for cutting out the dagger
it.
Board all nicely and the mast step all nicely, and then for routing the seat tanks.
Yeah.
We actually did use a table saw, but we could have gotten away without it.
Yeah,
we
used a lot of circular saw. We could have, anything we do with a table saw,
yep,
easily been done with a circular saw.
Yeah, circular
saw. We used a miter saw also, and we could have used a circular saw for that too.
Power sander was a really big one.
Power sander is a very big one.
Without a power sander, we would have been sad.
Yeah.
The big theme of the boat was Mark putting stuff on the boat and then sanding it for hours to make it perfect.
So,
I don't have the patience for
that. So a nice random orbit sander was good. Lots and lots of foam paintbrushes, plastic cups. We got good eventually by reusing plastic cups. So it seemed like if we had just plain epoxy mixed in one of these plastic cups, if we let it cure in there, we could pop it out.
Yeah, you just
and then reuse
the
cup.
Cup.
The cup would come out clean. And so, but we're doing a lot of thickened epoxy too, but we couldn't quite repeat that with the thickened epoxy because it would just get stuck in there. So we ended up getting good about having designated cups where this is just plain unthickened epoxy, that cup, because we can reuse it later. And then this is the dirty cup that we'll end up throwing out. So what other tools do we have? Scissors, little things.
We used scissors and we never used
plumb
a chisel.
Plumb bob's good.
Drill
a what?
Oh.
Oh yeah, drill. Yeah, power drill. That's one.
But yeah, it was surprising because when we started out, we barely owned any power tools. We owned a drill, a Dremel, which we never used.
Oh, I used a Dremel for the inspection part touch.
Oh, right.
But not necessary.
Not necessary. Could have been a big drill bit. But yeah, so we were just borrowing power tools here and there from Mark's parents. But yeah, we were just surprised that we didn't have to use that many of them.
So do you have much woodworking experience? I mean, this is...
This is pretty much our first.
This is trial by error?
Yeah. So I built an international 1 meter hole, but that's balsa wood, so that doesn't count at all, and it's 1 meter long. So that was the extent of my experience with woodworking.
Well, you actually built two of them.
I've actually built two of them.
Mark had been talking about for years, like we've known each other since we were kids, and he's always talking about like, oh, I want to build a full-size boat, I want to build a full-size boat, and I was always like, oh, that's going to take up so much space, come on, let's not do that. But then when I saw the El Toro, I was like, we should build one for the baby. So it worked out. Yeah.
It sounds like you had an awfully good time working together.
We did. It's really fun working on big projects like that. It's kind of our thing. So I think we'll definitely build another boat.
Yeah. And in the meantime, you bought a house, too.
Meantime, we bought a house.
Yeah,
so
we have to work on the house, too.
So the recommendation is when you want to build a boat, have a baby, build a house.
Correct. Right. Right. And
I have enough tools.
Yeah, the house is really going to help with the next one because then we don't have to go and drive up into the woods to my parents' house to work on it in the evening. Cause that was like,
yeah, by the time I was like in the third trimester of pregnancy, Mark's still like commuting up to his parents' house every night to work on this boat, and I was just like, forget it. I am staying home in my armchair. But if we had the boat at home, I would have kept helping a lot longer. It's just I don't want to get in the car at 6 p.m. and drive up into the woods every night.
Well, thank you for coming.